This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Well, today on Dreamland, we have a much beloved guest, someone you all know very well, and he has been part of this show and part of this website for a long time, and he is at least going to spend a day with us talking about his new book and his life, which is always absolutely fascinating, and the secrets of the human soul, the visitors, and owls. Mike Clelland is with us, and I'm so happy to see you back, Mike. Even though I know you're not coming back permanently, at least having an interview with you is great fun.
Thank you. It's an honor to be here.
Well, wonderful. Let's talk a little bit. We're going to talk about his new book. It's a novel. It's called The Unseen, and it's much more than a novel, as we shall see when we look at The Unseen in detail. But let's talk a little bit about your journey and where you are now. Tell us why you are in this experience, why you are in the close encounter experience at all.
Oh, good grief. Well, a wealth of personal experiences forced me into it, I guess.
Yes.
And there was a chapter of my life where I was trying to deny all that, push it away, said, no way, it can't be real, this can't be happening to me. I was reading stories, accounts of people with events very similar to mine. I believed all that, but I simply could not trust and believe it was happening to me. And all of that sort of culminated in, I was plagued by owl sightings, real owls. These weren't screen memories. I'm convinced they were real owls. And this started with a sort of fury around 2006. And these owls were really persistent in making themselves known. And I mean, it was, you know, often just owls following me through the forest when I was walking, or owls showing up around my house. Or it actually got to a point when I said, I will not pay attention to the owls if they're off on some fence post or on some power line off in the distance. They're going to have to cross my path in order for me to pay attention to them. This was around 2009. And I was riding my bike through the little town I was living in, and an owl, this is the day after, I think this was the day after, it might've been 2 days after, but I'm pretty sure it was the day after. I had made this plea. I literally went into the forest and essentially prayed and said, you know, I will not pay attention to owls unless they cross my path. In full daylight, this owl hopped off one tree, flew right at my eye level, right across my eye line as I was riding a bicycle, and then landed in a tree on the other side of the street. And that continued. And I eventually started looking to my own experiences. And Leo Sprinkle was near me, the wonderful gentleman who'd since passed. And I worked with him for a while, and I was really struggling at that chapter of my life. And so what was happening is I was looking into myself, into my own experiences. At the same time, I was looking into this owl mystery, which you had written about extensively in Communion and I think in Transformation. And I was researching myself essentially, and I was researching owls. And as I was looking into my own experiences, Leo was great. He would say, oh, you should talk to this person. I would call this person up. And one of the questions I started asking everyone is, have you ever had an odd experience with owls? And it wasn't 100%, but it was enough that there was a very real pattern. So I was getting so much confirmation that this owl thing was very much related to this UFO thing. And then I started a blog, and very early on in the blog, I started writing about owls, and very soon it became sort of the forefront of my research. And consequently, anyone anywhere in the world who typed in the words UFO owl into a search engine would find me. And they would send me their stories. And I started putting right on the top of my blog, right on top of my website. I'd said, I want to hear your owl stories. And I was flooded with them, And they were all remarkable. And so I say this often, I'm not looking at the big grand spectrum. I'm not looking at the full mystery of the UFO experience. I'm looking at the very narrow sliver of UFOs and owls and how they seem to play into this mystery. And what has happened is within that little narrow sliver of research, the reports have been really remarkable, and they tell a much more mystical and a much more spiritual and a much more, I almost want to say, theatrical story than gets told in other aspects of the mystery. So that, you know, so I say up front that I am not an objective researcher. Excuse me, I'm not a subjective researcher, I'm completely objective. I think I got that right. And so I'm putting myself right into the story, and I because of my own direct experiences, I've been trying to, like, I'm not doing this research for someone else. I'm doing it for myself because it's a genuine mystery that has plagued me and that I'm struggling with. And I'm much more at peace these days than I was at other chapters of my life, but it's still a genuine mystery.
Well, you know, owls, of course, are a huge symbol in the whole close encounter phenomenon. But interestingly enough, they also are related to all sorts of things that connect to what happens to people when they have close encounters. The transformative aspect of it. Mm-hmm. That you go from one state of being to another when you have a close encounter. You gain intuition, and they are believed to tap into some kind of inner wisdom or inner knowledge. Of course, they're associated with mysteries and secrets. There's all kinds of Native Americans view owls as messengers and omens. I think it might be the Sioux who see them as harbingers of death. But not others. The Hopi, and I'm just flying here. I could have the tribes wrong or even backwards view them as a protection. They, in Celtic mythology, which is also very important in the close encounter phenomenon, they have to do with the underworld and with guidance into the underworld and guarding of sacred knowledge. Of course, Athena, the goddess of wisdom and warfare, is an owl, is presented as an owl. Interestingly enough, the Hindu goddess Kali is also a goddess of warfare and of wisdom, although not associated with the owl. She's much scarier than that. In any case, I've got that wrong. It's in Hinduism. Come on, Strieber, click Lakshmi.
Lakshmi
she's the Vahana of Lakshmi. That's right.
Yes, Lakshmi rides an owl.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
And Lakshmi, of course, is the goddess of wealth and wisdom.
And motherhood.
And Mother Earth, yeah. So tell us, you obviously know a lot about her, more about her than I do. So why don't you tell us a little bit about her relationship to the owl, since we seem to have ended up there.
Well, so I don't know that much about her beyond the fact that she has a mount that she rides. She's an owl, and she is the, in the West, so the Eastern tradition, the owl is a much more lighthearted mythic figure. Yes. And in the West, it's got a much darker lore. In Shakespeare, owls show up just before the death of a character, Macbeth, and in Julius Caesar, and that's common in English folklore. The hooting of an owl would be the harbinger of a death in the family.
Yes,
and that's the mythology. What I'm finding is exactly the opposite in the reports I'm getting. I've got a lot of accounts of owls and death. I would say that owls and death are equal, probably more, let's say. There's more accounts of owls and death than the owl and UFO in what people are reporting. So, but it's often an owl will show up after someone dies. And I have lots of stories where someone, most often a parent, will pass, and the grieving child, you know, usually an adult, will confronted with an owl. They will talk to the owl as if it is their dead parent. This is very common, and then this will coincide with the alleviation of the grief. Like the grieving process ends with an owl. If there's a pattern in my research, I'm getting a lot of stories that play out with that narrative. And so that to me is very heartening. So the owl is a very complex figure. It flies in the darkness. It has this shadow aspect all over it, but that doesn't necessarily make it bad. When I wrote the first book, The Messengers, that was a blue book that came out in 2015, I did not expect to write a book that had what I call a hopeful message, but that's exactly what emerged in the accounts. And by writing the book was my way of sort of wrestling with all the data and trying to make sense of it. And what emerged was a very hopeful story. And that story would be exactly what you said when you began all this, is the transformational process. The owl seems to be the totem of the transformational process, which I find is very heartening. A transformation doesn't make it easy. If people go through a transformation, often it's hard work, it's tough, but that doesn't make it bad.
Yeah, let's go back to when you were being addressed, I would say, addressed by the owls.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the grays, I have seen situations where a gray became an owl, and
mm-hmm.
And I've written about this, I believe, in A New World, about the way the way the grays relate to us is the way the owls relate to their prey, in that the grays will come in the night. They will take us out of our homes and enact what they're going to enact on us and then return us. The difference is this: an owl with his extraordinary hearing can actually hear animals running in their burrows underground, and with his great strong claws reaches down into the soil, rips open the burrow, and pulls out the animal, that is to say, abducts the animal into the sky. Of course, the animal is physically destroyed then. We're not, but something else is done to us. You got any feeling about what that might be? Besides, I mean, when I was abducted, they took sexual material from my body. I feel like I was the same person I was before, but am I? Are we? A big question, but how do you perceive this as changing us?
Well, metaphorically, yes, they are. The UFO and the owl is eerily silent in flight. That's one thing. And then the strongest correlation to that would be the shamanic initiation. And within the you know, we would call this a primitive tribe. We in the West would say, you know, these societies, these primitive societies, I think that's the wrong word, but these societies that are not part of our normal Western culture, they would have a shaman that lived in the village. And the initiation process for the shaman is a death and rebirth process. Symbolically, there are traditions where they'll take the initiate and put him in a cave. The initiate does not have a choice. This is something that's interesting about shamanism as it's practiced throughout the world. And this is fairly consistent, is that nobody chooses. No one says, oh, I'm going to be the next shaman. I want to be the next shaman in the village. Usually the person first goes through what we would call a psychological breakup or like a psychological crisis. It's known as shaman sickness in other cultures. It's well understood in cultures outside our own. The Stanislav Grof came up with another term for it, a more westernized term for it, and I'll think of that in a second. But Kundalini awakening, spiritual crisis, shaman sickness, those are all essentially the same thing. And then the initiate is chosen by the village elders, and then they are put through a metaphoric death and rebirth situation, whether it's some sort of ritual through... each tradition is different, but the ritual is often very tough. I mean, John Mack writes about a shamanic initiation where they took the young initiate and like staked him out onto the anthill naked and like tortured him symbolically to death. And then he became the village shaman. So I would argue cautiously, because this is speculation only, that the people who have had the UFO contact experiences seem to be going through an initiation process that mirrors the initiation process that would be the shamanic initiation. And this was written about, Dr. Mack wrote about this beautifully in Passport to the Cosmos. And I read that book very early on in my own exploration of myself, really. And it really informed me in a way that has been sort of the backbone of how I look at this.
You know, we're in an initiatory era. The initiation is happening to many, many people in many different ways. The near-death experience is initiation.
Mm-hmm. There's a death and rebirth.
Yeah, perfect. Exactly. Yeah. And that I point that out in Afterlife Revolution, that many people are being initiated by the near-death experience. And simply because medicine is capable of bringing us back from the dead, as it did my wife, and it changed her mm-hmm. being completely. When she actually faced death, like so many NDE experiences, she wasn't afraid at all. She was mainly interested in managing her death the way she wanted to. And mm-hmm. she even tested toward the end her ability to, when she could no longer speak, when people can no longer speak, in their dying process, they can often use telepathy. And she tested her telepathy by telling my daughter-in-law to go get her a pair of red pajamas and that she wanted to die in red pajamas. And it was not because any special reason, I'm sure. I think it was simply to be sure the telepathy was working right. Anne was always very careful about testing things out. And so, you know, Julie leapt up and rushed out and bought red pajamas and came rushing back, and we got her dressed in them. But my point is this, that there is so much initiation going on in our world. The whole close encounter experience is a massive initiatory experience. And this gets me back to your initiation. The sudden appearance, when exactly did the owls begin to appear in your life? What were you doing then?
In the autumn of 2006 is when it started happening. And I was, at that point, I was working for an owl school. I was spending a ton of time in the mountains outdoors, teaching oftentimes 30-day courses in Alaska, all throughout the West. I taught winter camping. And so I was in this intensely physical outdoor life, and I was also getting close to 50. Well, I would have been about 45 at that point. And I was just the job requirements, were getting harder and harder each year. The students were all in their 20s, and I was, you know, 25 years older than most of them. So there was going to be a time when I was going to be leaving that profession. And at the same time, I got very involved with reading a lot of spiritual literature, which I consider a lot of the UFO books, you know, should be on the same bookshelf as like spiritual literature and spiritual exploration type thing. So I was going through my own, you know, one chapter of my life was dying and a new chapter was about to be reborn. And I could feel it and I sensed it. And I knew I could see this one passion that I had. I knew it was going to fade away and disappear. And this new chapter of my life forced itself on me. And so it was a set of camping trips in 2006, and in early October of 2006 that changed everything. And I thought at the time, like, oh, you know, like I'm kind of this study, you know, like I'll do some Google searches on owls and be done with it. And, you know, that's getting close to 20 years ago now. And it's been a full-time job for me. And I'm happy. I'm content to have a narrow focus. It's helped me have a sort of, the subject is so big that it's almost intangible if you try to address
right,
too much.
It becomes totally diffuse. We're going to take a break now, and when we come back, we're going to begin to explore one of the most interesting things Mike has done. It's a book called The Unseen, and it's a novel. And don't please tune this out, because I said the word novel, and you're here just for the facts. The facts are a lot bigger than they look. And when we talk about this novel, you're going to get facts that you can't get any other way. So bear that in mind. We'll be right back.
Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us, because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncounty.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format, and believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
We're talking to Mike Clelland. He's been a podcaster on Unknown Country, and I always hold out the forlorn hope that he'll come back again in some way. And maybe he will, who knows? But not right now. And unless I'm wrong, actually, Mike, I haven't even asked you lately. Is it still not right now?
I have been trying to work on part two to The Unseen that has been slow going, and I write incredibly slow, but people have been asking me to do a part two. And then I did in fact start a podcast up again, and it's mostly just me talking to my friends within this field, people I know in this field, and that's been really rewarding. And I only do one show a month or one or two shows a month, and it just started up about a month ago. So,
well, if you want to host it on Unknown Country, we'd love to put a link up and do that for you, if you'd
like.
That's
a thought. Yes. Yeah.
Okay, good. Well, I'm glad to hear it. And I'm sure my listeners will be too, because we all loved your work. And I'd like them to be able to find you on the site rather than having to seek you out. So I know you have a lot of fans there. Now, we talked about briefly about this, the fact that we're in an initiatory era, and the unseen is essentially an initiatory book. A man finds himself unable to tell whether he's alive or dead. Would that be a fair assessment?
He gets lost. Yeah. He loses himself. Yeah.
Exactly. He really gets lost. And I think you're writing about you. I think John is Mike to an extent. He finds himself in a morgue, alive after being declared dead. Why did you choose that? Has that happened to you, or are you just aware of it?
Oh, that would be in the lore of the sort of New Age culture or whatever, paranormal culture, I guess. That would be called a walk-in. And I was certainly aware of that. I remember reading a book ages ago on the subject of walk-ins, where usually if someone commits suicide, they can be replaced by another identity. They have given up on their life and they get replaced by another identity. You know, this book began as a comic book. I wanted to do it as a graphic novel. I've been a professional illustrator all my life, and I really had the bug to do it as a novel. And this started around 2010, 11. So that's like almost 15 years ago. And I was planning to draw it all, and I had written a nice treatment out. And I talked to some people in the comic book industry, and they said, don't try to do a graphic novel all by yourself. You need a team to do it. You need to be part of a team, because it's just the amount of work it would make you crazy. And I really was crushed me. So I put it on a shelf and forgot about it. But the opening sequence in the hospital, basically a hospital for the criminally insane, that was a comic book element. That was a comic book story element. I fully wanted to do the book as a comic book. And then when, I guess it would have been around 2019, I started looking into I had just finished one book and I'm like, I need something to do. I looked at the old treatment that I had written 9 years earlier, 8 or 9 years earlier. And I said, you know, there's something to this. I'm going to try to write this in fiction. And wow, was that hard. And I would love to ask you some questions about writing fiction. I was astonished at how challenging it was. And, so you asked about the element in the beginning. I wanted to do it as a comic book. A comic book has its own kind of life, has its own kind of story, narrative, has its own feel. And my sort of mantra as I was writing was to honor that comic book aspect. Oh, and I had the title The Unseen for the book. And in 2018, you asked me to do the podcast, and I had to come up with a name. And boy, try to go online and look up names. So like there's everybody and their brother is doing a paranormal podcast. So there's like, you know, was really tough to come up with a name. And I said, I never anticipated finishing this book. So I said, I'll just use the name The Unseen. That's got a great mystical kind of elusive, open-ended kind of vibe to it. So I used that name, never thinking that I would finish the book. But during the pandemic is when the book really got worked on. And it was just after the darkest days of the pandemic that the book came out. So,
well, in writing fiction, the first thing you have to do is shoo the audience out of your life. You have to get rid of them all, because there are going to be a lot of people watching over your shoulder in your mind, you know, friends, your fans, who you can only write for yourself. If you're not writing for you, you're not really writing anything. And the other thing is you have to become a whore. You have to become the whore of your characters. You take second fiddle to them. They become the leading they lead everything. People who design characters don't write good books. They write predictable books. People who are willing to say to themselves, okay, well, now so-and-so exists, and I have no idea what they're going to do. Those people write good books. It's why someone like Madame Bovary is so memorable, because it's obvious when the author was asked, who is Madame Bovary based on? He says, I am Madame Bovary. And that relationship between you and your characters is essential, and it's present too in your book, in The Unseen, very definitely present. And that's one of the things that drives the book. But the book has a deeper importance because of the journey it depicts. Oh, speaking of journeys, on the free side, we're going to go on a little journey into the world of commercials. And you're probably going to hear about them and communion and getting subscribing to the website. And also my book, Hidden Garden, my book of poems, which is out. We'll be right back.
There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is, if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is, can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is. And it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, soft cover, audiobook, and Kindle. Unknowncounty.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe, in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations. But more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real. And it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us, and join, very frankly, the future.
Mike, was there any particular experience that made you want to write this book before you had the idea of a comic book? Because did something specific happen? Did you come unstuck in reality? Because, or maybe you don't know it, but I remember it because I keep thinking of all these owls appearing in your life. Something was going on, and I'm not getting to the reason for it. In other words, most authors, most people I have on this show, when I ask them, well, what got you started? It'll always be something like, you know, well, I woke up one night and I heard a noise over the roof, and a UFO tried to drag my soul out of my body, and that got me started. Or I saw something, or this, or that. But in your case, it just seems that the owls kind of come into your life out of nowhere. Or is there something you're not telling us?
Oh, I'm pretty open about telling everything, I think. I don't hold much to my vest as far as that kind of thing. What I was finding was when I started getting the letters from people, and you know what this means more than anyone on earth probably, as far as receiving letters from people. I mean, I'm not getting what you were getting, but I'm one person, and I'm getting these people were sending me their accounts with owls and UFOs or owls and death. And what I found is I was talking to people, and and there's kind of a pop culture idea of what UFO contact would be, or let's say UFO abduction would be. And it involves, you know, being dragged from your car on a lonely road, or being taken from your bedroom on board a craft. And I've heard those stories. Those stories are out there. But when you really talk to folks, and when people open up and share stuff, what they talk about, and this was reflecting my own direct experience, was that my life had become so strange, mostly through seemingly impossible coincidences or powerful synchronicities. And that when you would talk to people, they would fight to try to tell the dreamlike quality of events in their life. And that was what I wanted to tap into, that quality right on the edge of normal reality, just as you tip into some alternate reality, that quality. And I say that because that's what I was hearing from people. And that's what I tried to capture. Let me just, in the opening pages, I wrote the very, like the sort of, before the story starts, I wrote, "This story is fiction, yet the emotions are real." So instead of trying to tell a story of facts and to try to make a point, I was trying to tell a story of emotions that tapped into just that liminal threshold between our normal waking reality and this more mystical dream language that seems to be playing out consistently in the lives of people who report these experiences.
The message, oh, by the way, Mike's website is simply mikecleland.com, C-L-E-L-L-A-N-D, mikecleland.com. And you have a, did you, you know, you're rather, I've never been able to quite pin you down about whether or not you did have, yeah, he laughs. He's the easiest person in the world to pin down. Not quite. No. I can pin you down on the fact that you're hard to pin down. That I can pin you down on. In any case, I'm going to sort of go at this again. The owls come into your life for a reason. And you've never really articulated that reason anywhere, I don't think. In other words, this doesn't happen to everybody. It doesn't happen to anybody, in fact, but it happened to you, to the point where you were basically hiding from owls who had come into your life to the extent that it became oppressive and more than a little frightening. But was there an initiating incident, Mike?
There was a there was an incident in 2013, where it was confirmed to me that this was real, and that the events surrounding what sure feels like a contact event in southern Utah, where the story takes place, much of the story takes place. And that's part of the reason I based it there, was because of that incident. But in 2013, it's interesting because I had actually written the treatment before this, what I call my confirmation event, took place. And this was, if I tell it, takes about a half hour to tell it properly, but, and I told it many times when I was hosting the show, on your site, where like I was in the act of processing that event for a decade after. But it was an event where I was sleeping outside under the stars, which also takes place a lot in the book. And it was something I really care about and still try to do a lot, is sleep outside under the stars. And people have asked me, oh, are you like trying to connect with the stars? I'm like, oh no, I'm trying to connect with the earth. Like, I want to be grounded on the earth. And, just a cluster of events happened that were so improbable that it just forced me to say, this is real, this is happening. And I gave up my denial. I gave up that fight to push it away. And in doing so, it was almost like I had a tape loop in my head that said, this can't be happening to you. This can't be happening to you. This can't be happening to you. But it was happening to me. And that the power of that one event, that confirmation event, and the cluster of events that surrounded it, allowed me to proceed onward. And without that tape loop, my life got easier. I'm still, it was challenges and such, but I didn't have that oppressive doubt anymore. So that doubt left me. And then what I realized years later is that I started writing The Messengers. It would be perfect if it was the next day. It was closer to 48 hours, probably less than 48 hours after the night in the desert on the night of March 10th, 2013. I had a confirmation event. This is real. And I started writing the book less than 48 hours after that event. So the implication is that it sure feels like I got taken aboard a flying saucer and I was told, you know, okay, you're here for a job. Do your job. That's what it feels like.
But I don't think you have direct memory. Or do you? Do you have direct memory?
I have a hypnosis session that I did with Yvonne Smith. That is the only place that is posted is on your site, the hypnosis session, the actual recording, which is pretty rough because you get to hear me swear and cry. In that hypnosis session, I am like confronted by a tribunal almost. It felt like I was on trial in a conference room on board what seemed to be a craft. And this would have been the events of the night of March 10th, 2013. And I got so angry at these beings. And they were like, you volunteered for this. And I was like, what are you talking about? I didn't volunteer for this. What are you talking about? Why am I here? What's happening? And they said, now is the time. And I just got in this loop and I got so angry at them. And I was so frustrated. And I screamed at them and I swore at them. And then it became totally like clear to me. Now, this is something that I've got to be very clear about this. This is a hypnosis session. I got to be very careful not to trust it as true, because I simply will never be able to know if it's true, and I'll make myself crazy if I try to believe it's true. So what I can say, it's a great story, and I can learn a lot from a story. I can follow a story. I don't have to believe the story, but I can follow the logic of the story. And it felt like I had been in a previous existence where they are. Whether that means I was some etheric light being or whether I lived on some other planet. And then I incarnated here on this planet in this lifetime. And the night of March 10th, 2013, they said, now is the time. And I started writing the book less than 48 hours later, the book that has defined my life, that big fat book on owls. And that turned into now four books on owls. And so I'm very cautious. Like I recognize the power of that story, but I still have to trust that I'm my own person. Like I don't feel like I don't want to lose myself in the mystery totally. I have to be grounded to some degree, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it certainly makes some sense in some ways. One of the problems with our efforts to ground ourselves is that we can accidentally push things away that are feel too airborne somehow. Mm-hmm. And that can happen. You call it the confirming event. And why is it confirming in particular? Why use that word?
Confirmation, because up until that point, I was filled with doubt. I was filled with denial. I was just unable to trust that these things had really happened to me. I wrote a memoir, and it's like, there's a lot of stuff that took place. Like, it's like kind of like I had to be pretty boneheaded and pretty, like I had to try pretty hard to not see what was plainly happening in my life. And then when I had the confirmation event, it was just so overwhelmingly clear that it wasn't just one event. It was that several events, three events actually, that all had clearly play out as UFO contact events. These three events lined up on a map in an eerie exactness. And I was sort of swimming in this kind of cloud of like psychic knowing, where I felt like I knew beforehand, like I, as soon as I saw that map, in a kind of psychic vision. I write about this extensively in my memoir. And then to have it play out so it's beyond probability that these three events would line up perfectly on a map over the span of southern Utah. And then later, just within the last year, I publish a book that takes place in southern Utah, where there's a, you know, that's the setting for this rather elusive story that is, I purposely tried to make it tough to pin down, because the mystery itself seems to be eluding us at every turn. It seems to be just a step or two out of phase with us, but we can certainly sense it's there.
This elusive story that is your life, Mike. Your life is an elusive story to everyone, including you, except there is one factor in your life that understands it and is not elusive. It's the owls themselves. And whatever is behind this strange apparitional presence, because no one has this. You know, you're unique in this respect. I mean, a lot of people have owl imagery associated with their contact experiences, but very few people have it to the extent that you did. Was someone trying to get you to notice? Was that what they were about?
Yes, it felt like I was being hit over the head with a 2x4 at times. It was not subtle. And it wasn't subtle. They're trying to get my attention. So it was very much felt like they were trying to get my attention. And then there's other people too. Chris Bledsoe came out with a book right around the same time last year called UFO of God. And there's owls all over that book. Boy, and it's a similar kind of initiatory vibe that they take on. They were showing up at the onset of his experiences. And he also had a very beautiful, powerful experience with an owl at the funeral of his father. So there is that owl and death imagery that is tangled up in this mystery too. So, you know, the UFO experience is tangled up with the shamanic initiation spirit experience, which is tangled up with the death experience. And each one of those events can be looked at as a transformational process.
Well, you know,
go on.
No. about owls. This is just an aside. My friend Jeffrey Kripal, who has become such an important part of my life, we wrote Supernatural together, and he facilitated the collection of the communion letters and now their digitization, which has been finished and will hopefully be available to the public as soon as the university's privacy rules can be, we're sure they're all protected, that the identities of the authors are all protected. So he's played an enormous role in my life and in this experience, a huge role in this experience. He's brought it into a new level of academic acceptance single-handedly. And if you go to Rice University, the first thing that stands out is the symbol of the university is the owl. And there are owls everywhere. Owl imagery is everywhere at Rice University. I found that very strange. I was shocked when I went there for the first time and suddenly I was seeing owls all over the place. I said, Jeff, what's going on? And so, yeah, the university's animal, symbolic animal, is the owl. So we are in the right place.
And you had where the hardcover version of The Supernatural has an owl eye featured prominently on the black cover with the yellow owl eye. It's a very striking, arresting, beautifully art-directed cover. Yeah. So it features strongly. Yeah.
One of us wanted that. I forget whether it was me or Jeff, but one of us wanted that. Oh, and Free Dreamlanders, I've got good news and bad news. The good news is you have come to the end of another wonderful edition of this show with a remarkable guest, something we manage to do more often than not. And the bad news is your part of the show is over. So goodbye. Have a great week. We're going to be back next week with another wonderful guest. And as I say hopelessly every week, go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe. Mike Clelland's website is mikeclelland.com. His new book, The Unseen, is a journey into something like fiction, something that has freed him to talk about a real and deeper journey that we are all on. And subscribers are going to go down that particular rabbit hole in just a moment. Free Dreamlanders, thank you for being with us.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.